Hello, everybody. I'm between my presentation is just before the lunch, so I'll try to stick to the timing. My name is Frederik Nasens. I'm from Belgium and part of the EMEA tech sales team of Wearscape. And I would like to talk about data warehouse automation for the next half an hour. So how to future-proof your infrastructure with data automation. So there are a lot of buzzwords in that title. So maybe let's split it apart and let's talk about data. Yeah, for a lot of people, data means data warehousing. If you're doing analytical things, does that still make sense, a data warehouse? And yeah, talk about automation, because everybody thinks or will imagine something different for that. Let me just explain a little bit about myself, and not by my career and things like that. So I've been building data warehouses, designing them for more than 15 years before joining the Wearscape team. But interesting is that over the last 10, 15 years, I've been part of teams, big teams, building huge data warehouses at Telco in Belgium, and where it took 17 different people to have a new data set added in a source system, to have it from there propagated through all the EDW staging, EDW, data mart, into the report. 17 people involved. That was, somebody made the analysis at that customer, and we all fell over, because 17 people involved, each of them has his own manager, and that's a lot of interaction points. Were we agile? I would imagine not. Another observation was that another customer was that I got to a score of 5 out of 70 slowly changing dimensions. So typically what you want in an ideal world is, if you have a data warehouse Kimball style and you're using slowly changing dimensions, they're all done the same way, because the data warehouse is never finished. So maybe next year I have to refactor that dimension. If it's all done the same way, I know what's happening there. Everything is under control, low technical debt. Yeah, 5 out of 70. Why was that happening? We were using integration tools that you use as a free canvas. And so actually you could see the experience, inexperience. Maybe you could even see if it was developed on a Monday morning or a Friday afternoon. And that's something which is blocking productivity. So here, two data points, the first one on productivity and the second one on standardization. And another data point is of last year. I did at a huge investment bank in Zurich. I did a proof of concept, and they said, okay, nice story you guys are telling, but let's prove that. So they say, okay, go sit next to the business, because in the business they have those fancy Excel documents with a myriad of things happening. You need to produce that in a documented, organized way. You know what? The business doesn't know everything immediately. So you need to work together. You need to, with your experience, your data and knowledge, work together. So it took us 17 iterations to get the figures right. But actually, that took us 3.5 hours. And that's the big difference. And that's the big difference with working in an old-fashioned waterfall approach versus a more automated agile way. It's about failing fast, doing things quickly. Did we develop it 100% following all the IT standards, the governance? No, we were prototyping. But once we've proven the prototype, we could then industrialize it later on. Okay, so data warehouse automation. Is that even relevant? Do we need a data warehouse? Is the data warehouse dead? Are there now, with all the buzzwords, better alternatives? And some new ones become old, some newer ones arrive. So we might say, hey, we don't need a data warehouse. We do, as a previous set, we put everything in the big data. We create a big data lake. That could be a way of doing things. Or what we hear all the time is that, well, actually, I don't need a data warehouse, because virtualization is going to solve everything. Or solution is the cloud, and then all my problems are solved. So those are things, messages we get all the time. Or, no, I forgot one, self-service BI answers everything. Do all those different toolings or philosophies don't make sense? Yes, they make sense, but they all have their use cases. And actually, we have to kind of redraw the picture and not have that silo data warehouse which is standing somewhere, that bulky data warehouse which is containing all the information. That's maybe not relevant anymore, but as analysts call it, you have the logical data warehouse, unifying data architecture. Yeah, it is containing the old data warehouse still there where we version data, but we add components, Hadoop components in there, streaming components, analytical applications, and that becomes actually my landscape, my data landscape. And that's actually where tools that are doing data warehouse automation are operating in. So we are kind of the plumbers that are trying to provide for all those data flows. So all the arrows, that's what we do. So, okay, we redraw the picture. So still relevant. But then we say, we talk all about agile. But agile, what do we mean with that? Well, I think that it makes sense to a little bit look at the past. What have we done over the last 15 years? What can we learn from that? We did a lot of good stuff, but we might have done stuff which is not that ideal. So if we look back, is that in the beginning, the first 10 years of my career, we were all building huge EDWs. EDWs, we say single version of the truth in it. And yes, some of them were very successful. It was cumbersome. It took a lot of pain, effort to get them right. So I'll kind of score myself 5 on 10 on that. There are some projects where I'm very proud of, some maybe not. A lot of control, because IT is owning this, so a lot of control was established, slow to get things done. What was another observation is that, typically you get all the data together, then you turn it into some insights to eventually make it actionable. And what we saw was that, a lot of ramp-up cost here, before here we slowly start to see the business value. That's a picture, C-level people don't like to see. So another one is this one. And in a lot of those big companies, you had very strong, very educated shadow IT teams that were doing things on servers below their desks or in an ad hoc way, in sandboxes. And sometimes environments, the sandboxes are bigger than the official IT data warehouse. And they get very quick return on investment, but it doesn't scale. It goes wrong at a certain moment in time. It doesn't work across departments. So okay, that's our issue. So what we truly want is to have something like this, where agile, it makes sense. It kind of scales. So yeah. Remember this one, single version of the truth. I've worked at a telco, and after 3 years, we still were not agreeing on the definition of a prepaid or a postpaid customer. And we're building an EDW with a single version of the truth in there, fully documented, but we couldn't agree. And you know what? We've kind of moved on of that. And that's the big change I see versus a few years ago, that we've moved on. We know now that there are different versions, and that's fine. We just have to make sure that we tag them, that we know which version we're talking about, that finance and marketing have different perspectives of things. And that's a big evolution you see. So I'm part of a software firm that sells automation software, but if you want to get a truly agile, well-working data warehouse, you sometimes have to rethink your architecture. For instance, here, this is typically something that is addressed by Data Vault as a modeling style, where you first create a raw vault in which you keep all the data unmodified, a little bit like the previous person explained in a lake, and then afterwards you apply the business rules. So instead of applying them when loading your EDW, which we used to do, you do them as late as possible to be as agile as possible. Because business rules, you understand them wrong from the business, you understand them correct, yay. But you implement them wrong, or you understood them correct, you implemented them correct, but they change next month. So those are three use cases where if you only store one version, you're screwed. So Datavolt is an answer for that. So automation, yes, we are tooling, but it is all about processes, people, architectural decisions you make, and then we can be that, yeah, we can give you superpowers to be even more faster. So yeah, this is a nice one, definitely in the Nordics. So single version of the truth in the perception. So yeah, in some cases, the data warehouse became a goal. And if that's the case, then you're wrong. A data warehouse is there to serve other purposes, processes. If it becomes, yeah, we're building a data, why are you building a data? Well, because we need one. No, that's wrong. It is an enabler for other processes. So yeah, agile data warehouses, maybe rethink where you're applying your business rules. What else can we learn? Yeah. Do we even need to do it? Well, yes, because it is still essential that if you're reporting in department B, a figure and an A, they need to match. They need to aggregate. So that's still a problem that's not solved by moving to a different cloud technology or whatever. So it is still relevant, our problem. So can we then redraw the picture? Is Datavolt then the absolute answer? If now we build everything in Datavolt, then it would be the answer. No, well, so if you look at our picture again, we've added other components. We might add some streaming to meet near real-time needs. But actually, a lot is still the same. So we still have the same question. How can I make sure that I get well-documented data flows that are versioning the data? If I want to see reproduce the figures next month of last year, I will still have them. They are not modified. It's documented. So yeah, I still need to persist it. Governance, all those things are still relevant here. I want to be able to report over time, auditing with all the new regulations coming out. It's even more important. So what do I do? Well, another thing I observed was that if you asked IT a question, hey, I have a data need, what you typically got was one size fits all, the same answer. Oh, I'll dock it with PowerCenter in our Oracle Data Warehouse, Kimball model, and then I'll add it into the semantic layer, and then you'll be able to create a report on top of it for business objects. That was for a lot of companies, they had one tool stack, one process stack. They said, okay, it all has to go into this lane. They didn't have different swim lanes to say, hey, excuse me, what is your question about? Is that a once-off question? Is that a marketing campaign that you're going to do once? So actually, I don't need all that governance. It's not necessary. So if you come up with your architecture, and this is kind of a union all slide, so where you're staging, you might have data stores, data vaults, 3NFs, Kimball models, or a combination of all of those. You have then IT, which says, okay, I want to control everything. And then you have the business says, okay, give it to me. And then you have that tension between the two parties. Then what you could do is say, hey, I create an EDW foundation over here, standardized, and then I give people access with data mars on top. That's a very good process. And it can be a phased process. It can happen in different phases. What I really like, it's not the best looking slide, but I really like this one, is that, hey, what if every data question you get from now on, you start to qualify it, and you qualify it by tagging it with a number. So four quadrants, based on, is it a systematic question, or is it an opportunistic? Means it's a one-off thing, or is it something that is, yeah, that data is part of the dashboard produced for the CEO. Okay, that needs to be governed. And is it push-pull system, source-driven, or is it demand-driven? Demand-driven means that I'm not really sure what the business wants, or is it, yeah, I have a source system, and what's in the source, I can apply business rules to it, and it's very clear for me. So what I now can do is, I can tag those quadrants and say, hey, actually, these are the company-wide facts information, that's what belongs over here. This is contextual for a business process, that's quadrant two. This is, yeah, ad hoc incubation, shadow IT, this is R&D, my data scientists. And if you qualify your data needs, what you might decide is that, hey, I have different processes for those. So you don't, if you need new data, well, maybe I'll allow you to dock that Excel into your Teradata sandbox so you can combine it with some information which is already over here or over there. That's just fine. But I'll make sure that whatever is in here, it has a limited life cycle. So it needs to expire in a few months. Because otherwise, it becomes standard report, and then it needs to be controlled, more controlled here. Another very interesting one is that what are the data movements between those quadrants you would allow? Well, context can enrich its data from the facts. This can be done as well. But this error, that's impossible. You don't want to have contextual quadrant one or two reading three or four, because your governed information, your controlled information is then enriched with something you don't have in control. So could really help you come up with different processes. And that could mean that, if you look at the previous slide, that for particular ad hoc R&D questions, you say, hey guys, you know what? You can directly connect to my staging layer, my ODS layer, or if you're managing that on your data lake, to my data lake to do that. But knowing that it comes with less certainties, less control, and eventually if you create something, some information which is an added value of the business, it then needs to become quadrant one or two. Okay, so a little bit about data warehouse makes sense, different shape. We need to reorganize how we build data warehouses, organize ourselves different. Big bang approaches don't work. Agile and incremental delivery. Keep adding things. Work in different steps, not end to end, but maybe build a data stage, a data layer first, an ODS first, and then give people access to it to prototype, and then take a prototype and turn it into a full-fledged data mart. Could be a way forward. Fail fast. So what about automation? You need to have good processes, good architecture, and then automation can give you that extra boost. So Warescape was created as so many different things. It started with a small idea in New Zealand. A consultancy firm in New Zealand that wrote down, it's somewhere on the wall over there, the post-its. The four things I never want to hear again from a customer. It takes me too long to change something. I never want to be able to keep this going, let's improve it, and so on. Those things are old in IT world, and 99, but they are all still relevant today for many, many people, for many companies. So, what's our solution? And my colleagues created that word, my UK colleagues, because I always pronounce it wrong. So, do we have now the magic solution for you? You buy Warescape or any other data warehouse automation solution out there, and you press the button, and we automagically generate your data warehouse for you. So, if you get excited right now, I'm going to have to disappoint you, because it doesn't exist. It's impossible. So, the big button where you click and it will generate your data warehouse, it does not exist. So, that's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is automation software is about helping you and automating parts of the process, boring parts, repetitive parts, so that in the end, you guys, who are all very expensive employees or consultants, all the time you spend on building those, designing those data flows is spent on the high-value work. You're not prepping a deployments to production. Needs to be perfect. But every second you spend on prepping, executing, or cleaning up afterwards is a minute you can't spend on something else. So let's automate that part and let you worry about the important stuff, the difficult stuff. So sorry for that. We don't have that button for you. But yeah, automation. Let's look at existing other sectors which are automated. So let's pick one. Let's pick automotive. And if you look at the construction line, the standard processes there, everything looks automated. But if you, it starts with listening to the customer, because somebody's deciding on, okay, I want a new car, a Volvo car or whatever. Well, which color? So there is input needed. And based on that input, a design is made. It's tailored to particular needs, because I'm sure last week I did a demo of our software to a company that is creating a worldwide catalog of all the nuclear bombs. So they have a dimension called DIM bomb. So not many companies have that. So there is uniqueness. Every company has its unique features. So that's where people are involved to make sure that that's captured. So we make a design, and then we need the spare parts. We need the data. We need the data from the sources. And once we've got it, then we can start building it. So in the construction line, then this happens. But if we zoom in a little bit and we look better, hey, what do I see here? I see people. So also in real life, I see people. And that's the same with building a data warehouse. So we can automate parts of it, but not the end-to-end. And a lot of people spend time on building all kinds of cool stuff. And you know what? Building generators, templates is cool. But we are there to deliver value for the business. So it's a combination of enabling you with superpowers, and it's a combination of standardizing what you're doing with templates, but you are in control. We need people to make the designs. Data warehouse automation, it is not about a set of templates which allow you to generate code in your development environment. That's not enough. Automation means that you automate perhaps your design. I have a source model. Let me automatically generate a data vault model. So your design principles, because if I do a design or you do a design, you'll do it differently. So let's standardize, within the company, the design process so it becomes repeatable, automated. Another one, development. Okay, let me generate 50 slowly changing dimensions. And you might say, hey, we are special. I meet a lot of people that say we're special. We do things differently. So what we've done is that we have ETL patterns in the software, but you can customize them. So if you decide to slowly change the dimension, I do it with hash keys, or I do it with surrogate keys, or I do it with this. You decide, you create your own pattern, and then you standardize, because there are no industry standards. I'm sorry, in BI, we're not that advanced compared to software development. We're not that advanced. There are no industry standards. You might think there is a Data Vault 2 standard, but I meet so many flavors of it. But you should have your own standard and stick to it. And that's where we can help. So by automating your design, your development, and your deployment process. So we have two modules, one that's doing design activities that can take a model. And we're not just creating a model for the sake of a model, but it's to drive your implementation. And then we have the one that actually building the code, the objects. And that can help you then to take a source model here, which you've profiled, and then click on your mini. We do have a button. Eh? Your mini button for this particular, that can take that model based on your rule set and turn it, for instance, into a data vault and generate all the ETL code to be able to load it. That's possible. Because in that raw vault, you do not need all the magic business rules. You need additional rules, but you can set it. So it's a limited scope. That's doable. Or another one is that, well, actually, I'm developing metadata. You're creating metadata, and I push a magic button, and I get code. And it's pages, hundreds, thousands of lines of code, which is running native on the database. I don't have to look at it, because I can, and that's cool as well. But it's based on my metadata. Yeah, metadata. I think I use that word a lot. And yeah, that's the key of automation. You capture your metadata. So we capture metadata, and then we use that metadata in an actionable way. So that metadata will be used to generate database structures, Hadoop structures, Snowflake tables, if you're using our software on Snowflake, whatever you want. We'll generate the ETL code scheduling for you. But also other things which are important, where a lot of people don't have it. Even if you have a good working production environment, well, do you have documentation? Do you have end-to-end lineage? Do you have a business glossary which gives you an inventory of all the attributes you've loaded in your data warehouse? Those are also things. Who likes to write documentation? Somebody said yes. I've never been a big fan of writing documentation, but you need it from time to time. And the cool part is that in our software or in any automation framework, you're working in a standardized way. So you cannot create a data set in Wearscape without giving it context. So you don't have to tell document that the dimension is dimension because the system knows it. So maybe I just need to document why I created that dimension. That's the only thing I need to do. And what you know what? That documentation, let's do that in the metadata as well. So it's a one package and it stays together. Because yeah, what's the most used documentation tool in data flow documentation in the world? Anybody? Excel. But you know what? If you click save in Excel, automatically your ETL environment is out of date, or the other way around. It's never. So if I ask you, what is the business rule? Where do you go and look? Do you go and look in your Excel documentation? I never did. I looked the code, and not the code even in development, but in production, because all the rest I would not trust. And that's something by applying automation you can resolve, because the documentation is always correct, because it's using the same metadata as all the generated code. Then a little bit technically is that most of the automation packages out there, they're working as an ELT orchestration engine. That means that actually they're not doing anything. They're just orchestrating the code, which is then sent to Hadoop clusters, to the Teradata databases, to the Redshifts, and are executed there. That might seem like a technical detail, but actually that's very powerful, because you don't have a black box, as you see right now. Because we generate SQL code, we generate native code to the environment. So if something goes wrong, if you don't like it, you can still investigate the code. So in production, what's running? Well, that's native SQL Server code, Oracle code, Nitizza code. It's not your automation tool which is running there natively. So you are in control. I'm a control freak by nature. So I like abstraction because it gives me productivity, but I want to keep being in control. So things we'd like to offer is that, we orchestrate a database, but wait a minute. If you have a very powerful machine, you need to then to tell it really good instructions. So it needs to be detailed and perfect. So it needs to be deeply integrated. Otherwise, sending ANSI SQL to a Teradata box is maybe not the best way to load billions of records. You need to have tuned code that is respecting all the particularities of the underlying platform. Also that I mentioned Kimball. I mentioned DataVault. A lot of people are building EDWs using 3NF. I met somebody yesterday who's big into anchor modeling, which I think is a Nordic invention. We're flexible. We have to be. We're a one-trick pony. We sell ELT software, so we are flexible. I have my personal opinions on all the modeling styles, but we want to automate your environment. So if you decide to use a particular product, the particular modeling style, we're there to help you. It's not the other way around. You shouldn't change your architecture to meet our expectations. Again, data-driven versus model-driven. I found that very important. Are you building a data mart for the marketing department and they have no clue what they want? Neither do you as a techie. So let's just sit together and build the first draft and then let's keep iterating over it. That's data-driven. Or are you talking about unlocking a source system with 1,000 tables? Yeah, let's not do it this way. Let's do it a model-driven. Let's come up with naming conventions. Let's do proper analysis profiling. Create a model and then execute that model into actionable metadata. So you choose. And that means that, we have that. That's the typical place where data warehouse automations tool play a role. When I joined Wearscape, there was no Hadoop version. It was created later on. Now we're working on streaming. Cloud is supported because we're working natively in the database. For us, it is easy then to jump onto a cloud platform as well. So we future-proof your architecture because, we follow the marketplace. So if you have metadata now that's enabling you to load the SQL Server system, we could tomorrow load with different templates a Snowflake system, a Redshift system. That's perfectly possible. Voilà, that's what I wanted to show. I don't know where I'm on time. I always try to come up with... So the idea here is to give your team superpowers. Given you make the right architectural choices, the right process, because tooling does not solve any process issues out there. But you can then optimize the performance of your team enormously. So I always try to come up with new analogies or try to explain to my kids what I'm doing as a profession, which is a horrible thing. So I came up with Super Mario, because I always say we are the data plumbers. We're invisible. We make reporting tools, analytical tools shine, but we are the ones connecting all the data, laying out the data pipes. I was discussing it with my colleague yesterday, and he mentioned, and actually last week they published an article that Super Mario is no longer a plumber. He is now something else. So I have to, this analogy will not work. So he's no longer a data plumber. It's an official communication. Okay, that's a short insight in data warehouse automation. I hope you found it interesting. If you want to see more about it, some use cases, I didn't show any customer use cases, come and see us at our booth. Enjoy your lunch. Thank you.